one of our key targets is the industry, is how we can create business around the use of Galileo and now also Copernicus and other space data.
Hi, I'm Lukasz and this is Space Talks, the place when you can get inspired by a space sector. In this episode, I will talk about satellite navigation and how you can do business on this. My today's guest is Justyna Radełkiewicz, Head of Section Consumer Solutions at the European Union Agency for the Space Program. So let's hear more about these opportunities. Justyna, first, a little surprise for you. The day we record this interview, it's exactly 5 years since we met, and it was in 2016 at an InfoShare business conference in Gdańsk, Poland. It's exactly five
okay.
years.
Okay. I didn't remember, but I'm happy to celebrate this anniversary.
So far you represented the GSA agency, which is the EU institution that manages the European satellite navigation system Galileo. But before we move on, we have to mention that for a few weeks now, you have been representing an enlarged version of this institution, namely the European Union Agency for Space Program, EUSPA. What is EUSPA and how does it differ from the GSA?
Okay, yes, indeed, we need to do this small clarification. So since exactly 12th of May this year, the GSA stopped existing and a new agency, EU agency, was appearing in this place. So the European Agency for Space Program is a new agency of the European Union that is dealing with the European space programs, but not only Galileo and EGNOS as the GSA was doing, but also all the other European space programs such as Copernicus, GovSatcom, SSA and SST. And the role of EUSPA is to bring those satellite services to the final users. So our role is to ensure that the space data are used, that there are no barriers in the market for this use, that the companies have possibilities to integrate the space data in their services and products, and that there is some sustainable growth or economic growth or societal benefits are generated from the use of this space data.
And let me ask you the question that I have frequently been hearing for several weeks, because there is also a European Space Agency. So do we have to have as many as two space agencies in Europe, while countries stronger than us in the space focus on only one institution?
Yes, indeed. There is a need and a place and very clear role for both agencies. So both responsibilities of both agencies are very clearly defined by the legislator in the new space regulation. I give you just an example. In the case of Galileo and EGNOS, the European Space Agency is responsible more for building the system, for putting the satellites in orbit, for creating this new technology. While the European Space European Agency for Space Program is responsible to bring those services to the users. So we are operating the services, we are helping companies to use those signals and services, we are supporting their integration in receivers, and we are supporting companies, startups, in creating businesses around those services. So this is just an example for Galileo and EGNOS, but there is also a clear division and split of responsibilities for Copernicus, GovSatcom, and so on. So also what is important to mention is that the European Space Agency is an international organization that is based in Europe, but is not an agency of the European Union. So the European Agency for Space Program is part of the European Union government.
Now that's clear. So let's talk for a moment about the Galileo system itself, where we started. We often speak about satellite navigation, often using the colloquial phrase GPS, but we should talk about satellite navigations. How many of these systems are there in the world today?
Yeah, that's correct. So it's long gone the time when we had only GPS. For many years now, we have also the Russian system available that is called GLONASS, the Chinese system that is called Beidou. And in 2016, the European system Galileo started its operational services. And for the final user, the good news is that actually there is no need to choose between them. So all those systems are operating, are being used together in the devices. And many of us that have a smartphone bought after 2017 have actually all the four systems fully operational in our pocket, let's say. So apart from these four global satellite navigation constellations, we have also some regional constellations like the Indian system or the Japanese system. But in Europe, mostly these four are widely available.
So this is iPhone 11. Do I have Galileo inside?
In iPhone, starting from iPhone 7, Galileo is already available, as in many other brands, in Samsung, in Huawei, in Sony. So if you are interested, if your phone is using already Galileo, there is a special website created that is called usegalileo.eu. And there we list all the models, not only of smartphones, but also cars, airports that are, for example, receiving, have landing procedures for EGNOS. So everything around Galileo and EGNOS, in all application areas, you can be informed and check there.
Ah, that's interesting. So what is Galileo's current popularity and how does it stand out from these other systems you mentioned?
Okay, so Galileo today has already 2 billion users, and for us it is really an enormous success because 4 years ago when Galileo was declaring its first operational services, there was only one smartphone that was available with Galileo. Today we have hundreds of smartphone models. We have cars equipped with Galileo. Galileo is used on ships. Is used in tractors, is used in surveying devices. As I mentioned, on usegalileo.eu, all those models are listed. So it's very popular, and actually in Europe, almost every European citizen is already a Galileo user, even if they don't know about it. And now, why Galileo is a good system, is a good technology to be used. So all those four satellite navigation systems that I described before, they all have very similar technology. So from the technical point of view, all those satellites are basically flying clocks that send us their time. And based on the time difference, we can calculate our position on Earth. However, as with any technology, there is a technical progress. So the fact that Galileo was launched much later after GPS actually means also that the signals are more modern. If we compare, for example, a smartphone from today with a smartphone from 5 years ago, we can see that that there is a difference. And it's the same with Galileo. So the clocks that are deployed in Galileo satellites are very good quality. And the signal are also modern and very robust, very good quality. And what it means for the final user is better navigation and positioning performance. So we can see better accuracy. We got the fix faster, we are not lost anymore, like on which side of the street we are. Of course, it's not only thanks to Galileo. As I mentioned, in the phone, all the constellations work together. There are also some algorithms, techniques deployed on the phone, the same in the car. But Galileo is for sure contributing with its good signals. And now we are also deploying some special features that Galileo will have as the only constellation in the world. Recently, we started broadcasting the so-called authentication signal. So it will support more security-sensitive applications or liability-sensitive applications. So it will be possible to understand if we are being spoofed or if the signal that we are using in calculating the position is really coming from Galileo. So I think that Guerrilla has many new features to offer, and I really encourage the application developers or, you know, people from different industries that are listening to this interview to contact us and get more information.
That's my next question, actually. As also being a PR person, I remember very well a marketing campaign of Guerrilla system. It was called Accuracy Matters. It interestingly addressed the problem, for example, ordering a cab to exact address or restaurant search issues. Can you give us some more, some example of most exciting and maybe somehow surprising examples of business use of Guerrilla?
Mm-hmm. Yes, of course. So yes, that was a very interesting campaign. We were presenting there small videos of our everyday situations where we need better accuracy of position. And one of them was actually where the driver of the taxi is arriving to another side of the road and we cannot find each other or situations like that. But and let's not forget that today our main tool access to the digital world is the smartphone. That's why I keep saying, bringing examples using smartphones, because today we estimate around 50% of all the applications in our application store use location in one way or another. And then this location is used in a variety of use cases that we have during the day. But if we look more on the professional application side, what is really interesting for me is also the fact that Guerrilla is not used only in navigation positioning or estimation of velocity, but it's also used in timing. So this is something that not everybody maybe is aware of, that GNSS, because it is giving such a precise time, is used for timing and synchronization. For example, of mobile networks, of banking transactions, or on of energy grids. And this is maybe one of the less known applications of GNSS. Another one that I also particularly like is the precision agriculture. So we don't normally see this, that our tractors in the field, they can really apply pesticides, fertilizers, seeding operations, harvesting much more precise because of GNSS. And this is not only saving costs, but also saving the environment and making our food production healthier.
That's interesting, Green. Something for the maybe startups. As a GSA and now EU SPA, you run competitions for startups or technology designers. Can you tell me something more about this initiative? Who can participate in them and what they give to the winners of the such competitions?
Mm-hmm. Yes, of course. So as I was mentioning, one of our key target is the industry, is how we can create business around the use of Guerrilla and now also Copernicus and other space data. And we have started immediately in 2016 when Guerrilla had announced the first operational services with a series of hackathons gathering mobile application developers to innovate around Guerrilla. And after a few of these hackathons, when we had this network created, we realized that during the hackathon, there is a lot of creativity, idea generation and so on, but it's really a long time before this idea becomes a product. And so we decided to launch regularly a competition that would take a few months, where a team or a young professionals would come with an idea or already existing prototype. And over these few months would receive some financial contribution from us, but also mentoring in terms of business mentoring, technical mentoring, so they can really bring these products to the market. And we have great success with those competitions. In the last one called My Guerrilla Solution, we started with prototypes, and by the end of the program that took a few months, the teams, they had already paying customers. And this is something incredible, because even in startups funded by accelerators or venture capitals, this success rate is really difficult to be achieved, to have somebody really paying for the service and to have this product already in the market. And now we will continue with these activities. So we are preparing together with European Commission a big initiative that is called Cassini, And this initiative will address entrepreneurs from all the space downstream areas. And this Cassini initiative will approach every single step of the company. And so we will continue with the hackathons. And the first hackathon will already happen in June this year, 18 to 20 of June, in 10 different locations in Europe. We will continue with the acceleration programs like the My Gary Law series. So really, please stay tuned because information on that will appear very soon on our website. And we will also follow up after. So when the startup has already a product or solution developed, we have also created a very good network of private investors and accelerators to support further and not leave the company alone in the first years of operation. So really plenty of opportunities. Please sign up for our newsletter. Go to our website to understand more and contact us with any product solution idea that you have, because we are really happy and eager to help.
That's one of the goals of our conversation, to inspire new businesses. So let's talk about future a little bit. Can you tell us something about the trends in the development and use of satellite navigation and Earth observation system, mentioned the Copernicus? What should be we more interested in as a potential end users as well as business users?
Mm-hmm. Well, there is plenty of things that are happening. The market is very dynamic. We are having like a full unit that is dealing with market monitoring and technology monitoring. And in the case of GNSS, we issued last year a dedicated report that is describing all the trends and what's going on and what are the things to watch. Let me mention maybe four points on which I think summarize all the directions where the research and development and also commercial solutions are going. So we already mentioned accuracy, so I will not explain again, but this is still the trend to have affordable accuracy for everyone, because of course we used to have already with expensive surveying devices even 1 millimeter accuracy with GNSS, but what I'm saying is a decent decimeter accuracy available for everyone in mass market grade devices. The second dimension is connectivity. So now we see a big growth in applications within Internet of Things that are for tracking and monitoring of assets. And there, the most important developments are around connectivity, because the tracker doesn't need to know where it is. It's you, the solution provider, that needs to know where all your assets are. So there has to be some communication link between the assets and you. And this is also a big area of development. So we see the appearance of dedicated networks, of parts of telecommunication networks dedicated to IoT. And this trend is something for sure to watch. And the other two dimensions are security and availability. Security in terms of privacy, because location becomes a part of the data privacy discussion. And the security also means that my signal is secure, it's not spoofed, it's not hackable. Imagine that you have an autonomous car driving in the city. It is important that this location is not spoofed or hacked and the car is not entering into a pavement or a building. And this last dimension is availability. So we still are not there to have a seamless location at any point of time in any place. So still there are some challenges for location under the trees, inside of the buildings, the seamless switch between outdoor and indoor means. So I think these four dimensions really summarizes well what's going on with GNSS and location right now. For what concerns Earth observation, studying more and more about Copernicus, because I'm working for the last 10 years in GNSS, and now my department is taking over also the part of market development of Copernicus. we are all learning and about it, and I'm really inspired, and I believe that the main trend in Earth observation is Copernicus, because it is unbelievable how much data is available for free out there to use. And so we started to look at different business cases, and we realized that there is such a huge potential for this data use. For example, we started talking with telecom operators. Now they have to plan their 5G networks. And in order to optimize this planning, they can, you know, have all the data for free. Like, for example, in this place, should they put the telecom tower? Will there be more than 30 days of frost on average in winter? So how much heating they should put? You know, how far it is from the urban settlements, will there be some disruption caused by nearby vegetation? So all this is available, and it's available for free. And we are really amazed discovering more and more use cases and trying to bring the businesses and the providers of data together and to create a disruption in the market. This is our objective for the next years to come.
That's really, really amazing. So now let's talk a little bit about yourself. What prompted you to get involved in the space sector, and what drives you to do so?
Okay, thank you. So my story is a little bit unusual, because I haven't studied really any space-related subject, or at least in my main master many years ago. So I started my career in IT and telecommunications, and at some point living in Brussels, I read about this project of Galileo and EGNOS and European satellite navigation systems, and I thought to myself, like, wow, this is really cool. I didn't know about it, and I would love to work for a project like that. And actually, we have to be really careful of what we wish for, because sometimes the dreams come true. And a couple of years later, actually, I got pregnant, and I decided that as being a responsible future mom, I have to look for a new job that is more less demanding, less travel, and more calm. And I started applying for different jobs, and I found this opening in the GSA at that time in Brussels that was for market development of Galileo and EGNOS. And, you know, I was so determined. I was actually in the interviews in the 9th month of pregnancy. And I think I scared them so much that they decided to hire me. And of course, nothing of my arguments to change the job fulfilled, because the job is not less demanding, is not less travel. But it was, you know, and is until today the best adventure of my life. And I can only recommend to everyone to really join this beautiful you know, spaceship of European space programs. And I want to say that as USPA, we are going to hire now really many new people. There is maybe 20 openings right now on our website, so I really encourage everybody to take a look and join our team.
That's good to hear. Well, regarding the background, I'm historian, so it's totally a way of the space sector, if you think about that. So I always ask this last question to my guest, as my mission is to inspire by a space sector. So what advice can you give to people passionate about space and looking for the path to get involved in the industry?
Well, I would like to say that there has never been a better time to join the European space industry. And this is for two reasons. First of all, because there is plenty of opportunities. As I mentioned, many vacancies on USPA website, also other, you know, even in space industry is recruiting. And on the other hand, there is not enough supply, because still it's not in fashion, it's not so much in common to study a space-related subject. So there is plenty of opportunities, and what I would like to say also is not to get discouraged, because space may seem like a place where they only hire astronauts, but this is not true. In the space industry, in space environment, we need good project managers, we need good HR officers, we need good lawyers, and so really focus on your strengths. strengths, and if you are good in some area, sell this area and get involved in space.
Thank you very much. It was a pleasure to host you here on Space Talks. I hope we inspired a lot of people today.
I hope so too.